Nicodemus had a defining moment within his life. Nicodemus was a religious leader of the day. He was a man that was sitting on the council. And the idea that what he had is he worked with the Jewish individuals, and he worked with Rome, and his job was to make sure that the Jewish people did not cause an uprising against Rome, and Rome paid them very well just to make sure everybody was calm and everybody was okay. They didn't want an insurrection and they didn't want to fight. So the Jewish leaders of the day would go around to make sure everybody was taken care of, and Rome was happy with that. And Nicodemus at that time was saying, I can't handle somebody causing an uprising. I can't handle another religious leader coming up and causing problems. So he went around at night just to talk to Jesus to find out what was taking place. And Jesus said a couple things to him that opened his eyes. Last week we said it's like coming out of a dark cave into the bright light and you can't see, you don't understand. So sometimes we very easily want to go back into the cave. But sometimes we have to stay in the light. Sometimes we have to allow the penetrating light of God's word to get into us so we can see the truth, to see what we need to do. See, many people believe the life that they live now is good enough, and it's good enough for them to go to heaven. And we discussed last week that being good is not good enough. What we must do is stay in the light. We must allow God's truth to get into our hearts and our lives and to penetrate us to see exactly what our defining moments are. The theme verse for this month is John chapter 8, verse 31. If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. As we said, the word abide means cling into. If you allow the word of God, abide in the word, learn the word, love the word, let the word work within you, you are my disciple. And if you are my disciple, the word of God will allow the truth of God to open your eyes, to give you enlightenment, to give you those defining moments in time. Jesus taught that good people don't go to heaven. He said forgiven people go to heaven. Good people aren't good enough. And we talked about the thief on the cross last week and how he was not good, but yet he went to heaven. Sometimes we think that we are good. I can put the standard against somebody else. You know what? I'm not near as bad as them. I'm better than them, and they're pretty good. But, you know, I do enough good things that I'm okay. And sometimes we have a very distorted view of God. Sometimes we want to put God in our box. Sometimes we say, well, I don't believe God would do that. Or I don't believe God cares about that. I believe God should punish them. But I think God and I have a deal. And he winks at mine because I talk to him. But you know what? Your deal, man, I think God ought to punish you. Sometimes we have a distorted view of who God is and what God wants. And sometimes when we have a distorted view of who God is and what God wants, we can live our own life because God is okay with us. Our view of God may be different in every reality. And in every culture, it may be different. But we have to still, how do we know the truth? We have to abide in the word, and the word will reveal our truth. This religious leader had a defining moment. He was watching Jesus come in. He saw Jesus in the temple. He saw Jesus healing people, and he even heard about the water turning into wine. His job was to make sure everything was taken care of, and his job was to be good. His job was to make sure everybody does their job. And so he was watching Jesus, and he knew Jesus was different. He knew Jesus was unique. He has seen many people come in, and he saw many people think that they're the religious leader of the day, but Jesus had something different. And we see that when John chapter 3. In John chapter 3, I'd like to read it and then we're going to dissect a little bit and talk a little bit. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. In other words, he was a guy that between the Jews and Rome. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi. Now, the word rabbi means teacher, means master, which means Nicodemus is putting Jesus on the same level. Rabbi, teacher. We know, not I know, we know that you are a teacher that came from God. For no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. He's watching. And he said, this guy, there's something about Jesus. And we, the council, see that Jesus is quite different, and Jesus could cause some havoc with us. And Nicodemus came to Jesus in the cool of the night to speak to Jesus, not with the council, but with him personally, because he knew there was something different. They had been talking about Jesus. And Jesus answered and said to him, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Now that word born again can use born from above. In our culture today, we kind of quit using the word born again because it has some negative connotation because of our culture. But Jesus used it right here. Unless you're born again, you cannot see the kingdom of heaven. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Nicodemus is a smart guy. And he said, how can this be? How can this be? Can a grown man enter into his mother's womb and be born again? He knew that wasn't physical possibility. He knew Jesus was talking about a spiritual principle to give us enlightenment. But Jesus interrupted him right here. Right, probably in mid-sentence, Jesus knew the thing about Jesus. He always perceived in his heart what somebody was thinking. He always taught about what they were wondering about before they even had to ask the question. Jesus had the perception. He was God-man. He knew what you were thinking before you would even say it. Jesus said this. Jesus answered, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I say to you, you must be born again. The winds blow where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but cannot tell where it came from and where it goes. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. This is a spiritual aspect. It's not, you just because you're born doesn't mean that you go to heaven. Just because your descendants are Abraham doesn't mean you're going to heaven. Everyone that is born of the flesh is of the flesh. But you have to be born of the Spirit from above. You have to accept Jesus as who he is. And I am the way. Nicodemus in verse 9 says, Nicodemus answered and said to him, and this is exactly the thing that every one of us has to, sometime in our life, ask this question. How can these things be? This is about ready to turn on the spotlight right in Nicodemus's face. This is the awe moment that Nicodemus has. He's wondering, he's watching, he's looking at what's taking place, and he's asking the question that I hope all of us ask. How can these things be? If you're at church for the first time, or you're wondering about this Christianity thing, and you're saying, how can these things be? It doesn't make sense. It's not of the flesh. It's of the Spirit. Jesus answered and said to him, are you the teacher of Israel, and you do not know these things? In other words, he said, you're the smartest guy in the group. How do you not know these things? Most assuredly, I say to you, we speak what we know and testify that we have seen, and you do not receive our witness. If I have told you earthly things and you not believe, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended to heaven but he who came down from heaven, that is, the Son of Man who is in heaven. And that's me, Jesus. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, and whatever believes in him should perish but have eternal life. Nicodemus would know that story. That's a story of the wandering in the wilderness. And Nicodemus was listening to Jesus that knew the Old Testament and now is living a life different, totally different from the religious system of the day. Nicodemus thought it was to be good, to be law-abiding. The better you are, the more commandments that you keep, the closer you are to God. And yet God in the flesh is right in front of him and saying it's not about the law. It's not about what you can do. It's not about being good. What is it about? It's about accepting the one that came from heaven to die on the cross for your sins. This is what Jesus came to do. Nicodemus thought Jesus was going to enlighten them about God. Jesus came as God to redeem them. Jesus brought them into the phase of the world to be born again. To be born again. Nicodemus, I put down my abbreviation Nick, so I didn't know Nicodemus out all the time, so I put Dick. So I just said Nick, so Nicodemus. Nick thought some people were really bad. He thought some people were really good, but he thought he was over the top, above board. He thought that I keep all of the laws. There's nothing that will keep me away from the presence of God. And Jesus rocked his world in this brief conversation. He rocked his world because he said, you can keep the law. You can be good, but you can't be good enough. Just like the thief on the cross, he was not good enough. Here is the totally opposite of the thief on the cross. This guy would have never hung on the cross because he would never do anything wrong. But just because you're a thief on the cross and you're worthless, or you could be like Nicodemus and be perfect in everyone's sight, you still can't get to heaven because of your works. You can't get to heaven because you're bad, and you can't get to heaven because you're good. You have to get to heaven because of Jesus. Now, being born again is not about human efforts. It's not about human efforts. It's not about knowing. It's not about doing. And this is where the church in the past had some major issues. We would call it legalism, if you would. That if you did these things, or if you acted this way, or you didn't do this, or if you would do this, you would have a higher access to God. And we can't work our way to heaven. We must have faith in our Jesus to get us to heaven. It's not about human efforts. In verses 1 through 3, it says this: there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these things unless God is with them. No one can do these things unless God is with them. Listen, position doesn't save us. Popularity cannot save us. Prestige cannot save us. And is what Nicodemus is finding out, even piety does not save us. We can act as spiritual as we want to act. We can pray the long prayers. We can come to church and we can give all we want. But it's not about our piety. It's not about how good we are. It's not about as bad as we are. He did recognize that Jesus was a doorway because he came from God. This is unique to him. This is the first time that the rulers tried to understand who Jesus was, and they got a glimpse of what God was doing and how God could do this. The second thing is, being born again is about a personal relationship. A personal relationship. In verse 3 it says, most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot even see the kingdom of God. And Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born again when he's old? Can he enter into his womb a second time? And then I think Nicodemus was saying, can he? I don't understand it. I can't comprehend it. But this born again thing is awkward for me. I don't understand it. Physical birth does not allow us to get to heaven. Nicodemus thought that the physical birth, as long as I am a good guy, as long as I am the descendants, as long as I'm a Jew, as long as we get the Romans out of here, we're going to be fine. And Jesus right here is impacting his life. A new life comes from the spiritual birth. Now, here's a key word about the spiritual birth. Just because you're good doesn't mean that you're spiritual. Just because you don't do bad things doesn't mean that you're spiritual. Anytime that anyone has the power of God upon their life, the Holy Spirit comes and prompts them, and they give their life to Christ and they accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior. That is the spiritual birth. That is what Jesus is wanting us to do. Position in the church does not make us spiritual. You can be a deacon, a pastor, an elder at the church, doesn't make you spiritual. It doesn't. You can have all the knowledge of every book of the Bible. It doesn't make you spiritual. What makes us spiritual is, do we understand the prompting of God within our heart and within our lives? And do we do what the Holy Spirit has asked us to do? Do we give where he asked us to give? Do we talk where he asked us to talk? Do we share where he asked us to share? Or do we say, I came to church, I put in my spiritual duty, I'm spiritual because I came to church. You know, the church is full of people that are saved but are not mature. Maturity is not spirituality. What we have to do is we have to understand that the spiritual birth, life comes from the spiritual birth. When Jesus comes into our heart and we accept him as our Lord and Savior, that is a transformation state. That is when we say, I want God. I want to be born from above. I want to see things different. I want to act different. I want to do different things. I don't want to be of the flesh. I want to be of the Spirit. New birth is a sovereign birth. What's that mean? New birth is a sovereign birth. You can't have Jesus without the Holy Spirit prompting you to him. You can wonder about it all you want, but when the Holy Spirit, when God himself says, I want you, and we have an ability to see what God is saying, the Holy Spirit draws you to him. You can say, I believe, I believe, I believe, I believe. You can say prayers and say, I want to go to heaven. And you can say all the spiritual terminology that you want, but salvation is a spiritual aspect. It's a sovereign act. It's a God coming down for you that didn't deserve it. It's called grace, but we don't deserve it. But God says, I want to forgive you. I want to give to you eternal life. It's the sovereign act of God giving his son so we can have heaven. And he doesn't make us get saved. He doesn't say, I'm making you get saved. He's saying, I'm giving you an opportunity. I'm sharing with you what Jesus Christ has done within your life. And it's your job to be born again, born from above. Jesus came so we have that opportunity. It's a sovereign gift. It's a sovereign birth. This is God initiated and God powered. You know, that's pretty powerful. God initiated and God powered. It's not in your own power and it's not in your ability. Because to be honest with you, in our own ability, what are we? We're worthless. We can't do anything in our own. You take God out of the scenario, you take the power of God out of your life, you are full of the flesh and you are going to sin. But when we die to ourselves daily and ask God to control us on a daily basis, that's when we have the power to live a life that's way better than we could do in the flesh. It's a sovereign, sovereign birth. When we think about that sovereign birth, we think about the balance scheme. That as long as I do more good than I do bad, I'm good. And Jesus is saying, guys, that scheme, that scale is a worthless mindset of a scale. Because we are all guilty. We're all worthless. We can't go to heaven on our own because God has given to us that gift. Now, we have to understand the new birth, being born again, is a supernatural act. The same question we must ask, that Nicodemus asked, how can this be? How can this be, this supernatural act? What is this Jesus thing all about? Why? And we can look at this, and Nicodemus knew law. And his job was to make sure everybody else obeyed the law. And his job was to make sure the Jews didn't cause an uprising and the Rome did not come down and cause a major problem. They just wanted it to be happy. So Nicodemus asked them a question. How can this be? Or I think a better question that we ask today is a simple word is why? Why? Why does this have to happen? If I am doing a good job and I'm okay and I take care of everybody, why would I even need Jesus? Why would I need salvation? So in every area of our life, that one question should be asked in every area. Why? Why? Wouldn't that be it? Your kids say that all the time. Why? But that's a question that we should ask Christ. Why? Because then Jesus would give us that answer. And you knowing that answer probably quite well is because when sin entered into this world, we needed a Savior. And the rules of the day could not save us. The 613 laws did not get us closer to God. It made us distant from God. The piety of the law that we could not keep made a major vacuum. And God said in his divine nature, I am going to give to you a reconciliation. I'm going to give to you Jesus. And you can be born of the flesh and you'll die in the flesh. But when I give to you Jesus, the Lamb that takes away the sins of the world, when you accept him and you are born with water and spirit, you are going to be a saved individual. I am going to do my part by giving to you Jesus. And write down this verse. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. It is a supernatural act. Christ explains this new birth, not to science. It can't be scienced. It can't be bottled up. It is not a human formula. It is not to be explained. It is to be experienced. When somebody says, are you born again? Yes. How did that happen? Well, I was prompted. I was convicted. I knew that I couldn't get to heaven on my own. I knew that I was a sinner, and I knew that I did not have a relationship with God. And I knew at that time that there had to be something different within my life because my path of life was not going in the right way. I couldn't bottle it up, and I can't give to you salvation and say, here, Brian, here's salvation, and you catch a bottle, and you keep this bottle. Well, Bruce gave me salvation. I can't give you salvation. I can receive salvation from God because it's a supernatural act, but I cannot give to you my salvation. Our salvation is an individual act, a sovereign act from God to us. Some of this could be disturbing. Some of this could be, well, I was always taught that as long as I was a member of a church, or I was always taught that as long as I read my Bible, or I was always taught that as long as I was baptized when I was a baby, I was always taught that I was okay because of where I came from and who my family was. And Jesus saying, that's not the case. That's not the case. You can't be good enough and you can't go someplace enough to go to heaven. It is an individual act born of the Spirit. Being born again comes from only through the man-God relationship. Only through that man-God relationship. And it says in verse 13, no one ascended to heaven but he who came down from heaven, that is the Son of Man, which is Jesus, who is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so the Son of Man must be lifted up, and whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The relationship demanded God himself come to this earth to explain it. This had to be Jesus come to this earth. And he started this conversation with Nicodemus. You can't get to heaven on your own. I have to explain it to you. I have to explain to you what you need. How could this be? Why? Why? I'm good. I keep the law. My parents tell me I'm good. My church tells me I'm good. I've been baptized. I'm good enough. And Jesus is saying, all that stuff isn't good. You have to have that personal relationship, being born from above, being born of God by that salvation through me. And when I am lifted up, when somebody lifts up the name of Jesus and you say, I don't understand it. Can you tell me a little bit about it? And the Bible says in John chapter 8, if we abide, if we look at the word and we understand the word, the truth will be revealed to us. So we say, who is this Jesus? Or I don't understand it. It's not about listening to it one time. It's about, I have to investigate that. I have to ask that question, how could this be? I have to ask that question, why? And Jesus came to Nicodemus to tell him, you're not good enough. You have to come through me. And he's never heard that before. A relationship demanded God himself to be lifted up in sacrifice, to be lifted up in sacrifice. Jesus did not only come to this earth to be born, to live 33 years. Jesus came to this earth to be our punishment, to be our propitiation, our covering for our sins. So the Bible says, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. There was a plague or a disease that was going around in the wilderness, and Moses pleaded to God. And God gave to him the idea, here's what you need to do. You need to put a bronze serpent on a pole. And you need to put that pole in the midst of the camp. And anyone that looks at that serpent will be healed. Now, Moses thought, how can that be? That's kind of stupid. But, you know, God, that's what you want. That's fine. And Moses had no idea what he was doing. But Jesus knew what he did. And Jesus said, just like Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness and said, if you are sick, if you are dying, if you need help, look at the serpent. And here Jesus is telling Nicodemus, and he knew that story because he was an Old Testament prophet, or he knew all the Old Testament. He said, just as the serpent was lifted up in the wilderness, the Son of Man must be lifted up on that cross. And whoever looks at him will be saved. Old Testament was a serpent. Anybody looked at him, you can be saved. Now Jesus is saying, just like you did in the Old Testament, just like your forefathers did, you must look at me to be saved. You can't get saved on your own. You can't be good enough. You can't just look at Jesus and wonder. You have to look at his sacrifice that he has committed. The relationship demands that we look at God in belief. In belief. See, a lot of times we look at God in disbelief. We look at God out of guilt. We look at God because we were told we have to look at God. And God doesn't want us to look at him because of punishment. God doesn't want us to look at God and say, oh, I'm scared of what he's going to do. I'm scared. I'll be beaten to submission. I'll go to church, or I'll give my money, or I'll teach the class, or I'll drive the bus. I'll do, because I want God to be happy. I want God to be happy. We can't make God happy because you're doing good works. God loves you unconditionally. You can't do anything more to have God love you. You can't do anything less for God not to love you. God loves us unconditionally. We don't understand that. But God wants us to look at us with belief that he loves us. Belief, it's unconditional love for us. It is not out of duty. It's not out of works. It's not out of law. It's out of love. People do not earn their way to heaven. Heaven is given to them. All we have to do is accept that gift. And when we accept that gift is free. We have to accept that gift with belief. A defining moment sometimes is when you hear something. I had a wedding yesterday, and I was talking to the family at the wedding, and they said, "Now, Bruce, I was born in church. I grew up in church, and it was in South Carolina, by the way. I was born in church and went to school at church. They had a school there. So I thought that's how you raised your kids. So I grew up and I raised my kids, and I wanted my kids to experience what I experienced. So I made them go to that school, and I made them to not do a lot of stuff that that they told me not to do. But Bruce, I found out as soon as my kids got to be 16, 17, 18 years of age, they didn't want to go to church anymore. They didn't like what I liked. They didn't like the rules and the regulations and the church police being involved in all of their life. And I said, very simply, I said, you know what? You can't police your kids' sin. What you can do is you can give to them Jesus. You can give to them the Word of God. And the Word of God is going to enlighten them and to tell them what they should or what they should not do. But if you think that you co-parenting your kids with rules and regulations in the church, those kids are going to rebel against the church. Because God is love. God is not law. When God is love, we give to them what the truth of what Jesus is. And we serve Jesus because we love him. We serve Jesus because we want to honor him. We worship Jesus not because he's going to be mad at us if we don't. We worship him because of what he did for us. And anytime that we make people serve, worship, or give out of condemnation and guilt, they'll do it in the moment, but they'll regret it and refrain from it in freedom. I don't want to do that. So when we teach our kids that we need to go to church because we love God, not because you have to, that everything is a sin because my pastor told me it was a sin, that's not what God is trying to get us to do. The Bible is very unique. See, Jesus had this conversation with Nicodemus in John chapter 3. And John wrote the Bible years later. And at the end of that conversation of Jesus and Nicodemus, and Jesus and Nicodemus were sitting at night, clearly John was there, because John, after that conversation up to verse 15, John puts into a verse that tells us what Jesus told Nicodemus. And it's the most popular verse in the Bible. And it's John chapter 3, verses 16 and 17, right after the story of Nicodemus. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. You know, the judgment of this world is at the time of Adam and Eve, when sin entered in the world, the relationship with God and man was broken. It was broken. There was a gap. Man could not get to God because of sin. And the judgment of that was because man and God broke that relationship, that judgment was already there. Jesus came not to fulfill that judgment, but to change that judgment from condemnation to salvation. Jesus came, and Nicodemus, it was an awe moment. He didn't get it for a while, but he stayed in the light. He didn't follow Jesus instantaneously. The light was shown. It was bright. And Nicodemus, how could this be? But he left, and he kept on following Jesus from a distance. He didn't stand up with him. He didn't follow him publicly, but he was an advocate for Jesus in the Sanhedrin. And just a few weeks ago, when we celebrated the death and the burial of our Lord Jesus Christ, do you know who it was that took the body of Jesus off the cross? It wasn't the disciples. It was Nicodemus. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. So that light was bright. He didn't fall on his knees and confess his sin. He didn't accept Jesus that night. He stayed at a distance. He watched what was going on. And he saw that Jesus was not just from God. He found out that Jesus was God. Amen. And when you get that enlightenment, it changes. He didn't care whether he lost his job. He didn't care if people laughed at him and ridiculed him. When it came down, when the light was shown the brightest, he didn't go back into the cave and keep his rules and do what he thought was right. He got out and he said, I know. I'm a follower of our Lord Jesus Christ. Maybe not publicly right off the bat, which the parallel is, maybe the light is shown into your eyes. Maybe you're saying, what do I do with this information? How can this be? Why am I here today? There's never an accident when it comes to spiritual nature. Amen. Jesus has you here for a purpose. You are here today to be enlightened. And the Bible says, if you abide in the Word, you are my disciple. And if you abide, stay in the Word, you are a disciple. The truth, the enlightenment phase of God's Word will give you truth. And that truth can make you free. It's not about your knowledge. It's not about your attendance. It's about abiding in the Word. And if you abide in the word, you are my disciple. And if you are my disciple, the truth of the word can give you enlightenment of life. So just like Nicodemus, how can this be? How can the thing that I thought about God be? We understand he's talking about a spiritual nature. We have to be born from above, but Nicodemus didn't understand that at that time. Is there something about God that you have a distortion about? Is there something that you believe God will do for you that he won't do for anybody else? We joke about this, but like at the ball fields, or the basketball court, or the football field, all the parents are saying, oh, take care of my, let my boy hit this home run, or let my boy make this last basket, or let me, and every parent is doing that on both teams. So what you're saying is, God, I'm more important than that entire team. You do what I want you to do because my boy's self-esteem needs it. And that boy's self-esteem is fine. I think it's mama's self-esteem that needs the problem, right, on these ball fields. But we have a distorted sense of that as long as I pray to God, God is going to be my little puppet and he's going to do everything I ask him to do. He is going to take care of me because I am important. And I want to say you are important. But whether God answers your simple prayer or answers your big prayer, it's all about what does God's will is for your life. Does God want your boy to have self-esteem and hit a baseball? Yes, I'm sure he does. But is God going to not let somebody else just so you can have your prayer answered? Probably not. How many of you guys have prayed for the lottery? Have you all won the lottery? I wish you guys would win the lottery and pay off this church, but that's all good. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him, not knoweth, believeth in him, should not perish, but have eternal life. How do you get born again? How can this be? We have to accept that Jesus is calling you. He loves you. He wants that reconciliation. He wants to bring you back with God. And he wants to give to you a love, not only to go to heaven when you die. He wants to give you forgiveness today. He wants to give you the ability to understand the enlightenment phase of what God wants for you today. It is a whole different dimension. We are of the flesh. We're going to do the things of the flesh. But when we are born from above, then we have the authority and the power and the ability to know the truth, to live our life pleasing to God. It may be hard. We may have some sin. We may have some addictions that we have to give over to God. We may have some things that we struggle with, and that's okay. That's okay. God knows all your issues. God knows all your struggles. God knows all your addictions. And he's saying, listen, die daily, take up your cross, and follow me. In other words, the things that you struggle with on a daily basis, just give them to me. And it's not a secret. God knows. God wants you, and God loves you. So whatever it is, how can this be? Is give your life, give your sin, give your issues to Jesus and let him cover them with the blood that he shed. Let him take your issues and wipe them clean. Let him give you the power to live your life for him, not in the flesh, but in the spirit, not in what you can do, not in keeping the good, not in keeping the law. Look at what I can do and how good I am. Jesus blew Nicodemus out of the water with that. He said, listen, just watch it. In a few days, the thief, I'm going to take him to heaven. And if you stay where you are, the Holy One, the 613 laws, the piety, if you die where you are, you're going to hell. How could this be? Is it because it's not about as good as you are or as bad as you are? It's whose you are. And if you are Christ's, you are in Christ. You are born from heaven. That is the goal of every person on the planet. We want every person to be born again. How do we do that? Is by the born again, born above people. Not be ashamed. Not be ashamed. Kind of like Nicodemus. Let me see it. Let me process it. Let me understand it. But once I understand it, let me get after it. Let's not be ashamed of what Jesus Christ has done for us. Let's be proactive. Let's have that enlightenment phase. I am a believer. Not because of me, but because of Him. And He can change everything about us. So, our invitation is simple. What is it? What is it that you have not given to God? What is it that you hold on to? What is it that Jesus says, I want to come over and take over your life? And you say, well, I'll give you everything, but maybe you've never given your life to Christ. And He's saying, I need you to give your heart. Believe in me. And all of those things are so important. Every aspect is important. But many of us are probably believers. And if you're a believer, what is it that you're holding on to? If I would say, what owns you is what you have. You need to give that over to God too. The enlightenment stage is when you know the truth and you say, ha ha. But what do you do with that truth? What we do with the truth is, I can't be good enough and I'm not bad enough. Whether I'm good or whether I'm bad doesn't make a difference. It's what I do with the truth. Give our heart and give our life to Christ. Let's pray. Dear Father, Lord, we come before you. And Lord, we ask you to evaluate us. Turn the bright lights on in our soul. We need enlightenment. We need a defining moment within our life. And we know good people don't go to heaven. We know bad people don't go to heaven. We know forgiven people go to heaven. And you are the only one that can forgive us, because you are the only one that has the right to forgive us because of what you have done for us. And we worship you because of that. We honor you because we do that. We worship you at church because you have the ability to forgive us and what you've done for us. We're not good. We're not bad. We're yours. And whatever we have that's keeping us from that relationship, we want to give it to you. We want you to honor because you have forgiven. Love us, forgive us, and help us. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Would you please stand to your feet? An opportunity for you to pray. Ask God if He's given you some enlightenment and you want to talk to Him about some issues, feel free to come forward. Talk to Him about the thing that you need Him to show you.